Hello, insiders. This week, I have a very special guest. I got Todd from the search and discovery team with me today. Welcome, Todd.
Thanks for having me.
Now, Todd, people have been asking for this interview ever since we started the channel. So I'm super excited to kind of dig in a little bit to help people understand a little bit around how we recommend videos and how we think about that. Maybe we could just start by going over, like, what is the goal of the search and discovery team? Like, why do you guys exist?
Yeah, so there's, as you know, there's over 400 hours of video being uploaded to YouTube every minute. So that's, I think, like 72 days worth of content per day. And given that each person probably only has an hour or two to watch YouTube every day, it's our job to help them find what they want to watch. And not just what they're going to watch, but what they're going to want to enjoy and keep them coming back to YouTube every day to watch more videos. So really understand each viewer, what they like, and give them the videos that they're going to find engaging.
So how do you solve that problem? That sounds like a very kind of ambitious goal. Like, how do you break that down into a mental model?
Yeah. So the way we think about it is, our job is to follow the audience, mm-hmm. because by listening to the audience, we'll do a better job of giving them what they want. So the way we think about the systems that we build is that they're really a gigantic feedback loop for the audience. In any given day, we collect over 80 billion different pieces of feedback from the audience. We look at things like, well, what did they watch? What did we recommend that they decided not to watch? How long do they watch for? But increasingly, we're moving beyond just watch time as one of our key goals. We look at satisfaction signals, like, did they like it? Did they dislike it? When we recommended it on the homepage, did they say they were not interested? We give viewers the ability to tell us that, so we can stop recommending certain types of videos that they didn't like. And recently we even started using surveys to try to even better understand the audience and what they like and don't like. So we send out tens of thousands of surveys every day to people, asking them whether the recommendations we're giving them are good or not, as well as following up with people after they've watched a video to find out how enjoyable that video was. Was it one of the best videos they've ever seen, or was it kind of an average video? Because we believe that not every minute spent on YouTube is probably equally valued, and we want to be able to really recognize when viewers have maybe even a life-changing moment with a video so that we can recommend more videos like that.
Cool. Now, you've been on the team for 3 years.
Yeah.
I'm guessing you've seen a lot of interesting experiments, and the work that the team does has evolved over time. Could you share some examples of changes that have been made and maybe why you guys thought about making those changes?
Yeah, so, changes are happening all the time because we're always trying to get better about giving people the right content that they're going to find satisfying. At any given time, we probably have several dozen different experiments running with different changes that we think might help improve engagement and satisfaction. But we're also very careful about how many of those experiments make it into the final product. Each experiment gets tested with millions of viewers, so we really want to see how it does before we roll it out to everyone. And only a minority of those changes do we put into the final product, and we go through a review process for every change. And we look at dozens of metrics. I know that a lot of creators have kind of asked me, well, what's the one thing that I should focus on to be successful on YouTube? Is it watch time? Is it likes? Is it comments? And what we found over time is,
I've even asked you that question.
You have asked me that question.
Yeah.
And as you probably remember, I've said that, while I wish I could give you a simple answer, what we've learned to truly understand the audience and what they want is not just about just looking at one thing like watch time or likes, because, for example, with watch time, we've come across some changes in the past that we've considered, like, we had this one change recently that significantly increased watch time across YouTube. It actually If we would have rolled out this change, people would have watched millions more hours every day on YouTube. So you might think, well, obviously that's one of the good ones. Let's roll that one out. But when we looked at the dozens of metrics we looked at for each change, we found that there were some interesting things happening that weren't the same across all viewers. What was happening is, one, we were recommending longer videos on average.
Mm-hmm.
So you might see more videos that are like an hour long or more. But our hit rate in terms of like how often a viewer would find a video they want to watch was lower. So you'd be less likely to find a video, but when you did find one you liked, you might watch for longer. Mm-hmm. So overall watch time is up. But what was ultimately happening when we dug in was we were increasing engagement with a small, heavy segment of the audience, and actually reducing engagement from a casual user segment. And because we look not just at like the total volume of engagement, we also break it out and see how it's affecting different groups of viewers. And we care about growing the appeal of YouTube to more and more viewers over time. We felt that this wasn't representative of the type of change we wanted to make, because it was actually making the experience worse for a significant segment of viewers that we cared about. And so rather than make them pay the price for another segment, we said, let's go back and see if we can find a way to get the improvements here without hurting it for a different segment. So we look at these things very closely, and, you know, spend hours a week digging into the details, but ultimately it does change a lot in a given year. You know, 200 to 300 changes do end up happening, so it's a lot to keep up with. But you know, each change that we do roll out, we can be confident that we're making the experience better.
Cool. It's easy to think about. People often talk about the algorithm.
Yeah.
I think in reality, it's a little more nuanced than that. Maybe what we could do is talk about specific spots within YouTube where recommendations are made. Like, there's homepage, there's watch next, there is trending, search as well. Maybe could we step through, like, starting with homepage, how do you think about that solving that problem of recommendation, and then we can move on to the others.
Sounds great. Yeah. So, yeah, a lot of people talk about it as if it's just like one algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have different systems, and each surface or feature that the user sees kind of has its own set of systems behind it that are trying to optimize for whatever that feature is trying to achieve. So, for example, on the homepage, we are really trying to be the one-stop destination. So it's the first thing you see when you open it up on your mobile app or type YouTube.com into your browser. We really want to be as efficient as possible in helping you find something, whether it's a trending video or whether it's something by your favorite creator. We want to get you there as quickly as possible so you don't have to navigate around the app to find what you're looking for. So we're going to pull in videos from all sorts of different sources to try to find the ones that are going to resonate with you. So we'll pull in recent videos from the channels you subscribe to. We'll pull in videos that have been watched by people who tend to watch the same sorts of videos you do. We'll also pull in a few videos from channels you may have never watched before. It's actually a great place for channels to get discovered by people who aren't already subscribed to their channel. We found that the homepage actually used to be only your subscriptions. And oftentimes we'll get the question from creators or people internally asking, well, why don't we just, you know, since people have subscribed to those channels, why don't we just, give them what they subscribe to? We used to do that. As we've introduced more and not constrained the homepage to videos you've, you know, manually opted into, added more recommendations, the engagement has grown dramatically. And so we try to include both familiar content as well as discovery content. And every once in a while, we'll kind of retest to make sure that we've made the right decision there. And we'll run another one of those experiments with millions of users where we actually give them just the subscriptions when they start up the app. And we've done that several times since we made that change. And every time we see dramatic drops in engagement on home when we limit it just to subscriptions. So that's, if you had that question about why isn't it only subscriptions, it's because when we show that, people actually visit YouTube less often, which is not really what we're going for. So home is really that personalized one-stop shop that's supposed to bring the most relevant of YouTube to you without you having to type a query or navigate around the app.
Great. And I guess if for those who viewers who are super interested in just the people they're subscribed to, there is always the subscriptions tab.
That's right. It's just one tap away. Yeah. There's a subscription tab that filters down to the stuff that you've subscribed to, and it's we still offer that for the people who want to just jump into that as well.
Cool. What about Watch Next?
So Watch Next, that's what we call it in our team. Mm-hmm. Externally, sometimes people call it suggested videos. Mm-hmm. The recommendations you see on the sidebar while you're watching a video on desktop. This is one of our most powerful recommendation areas. Drives a huge amount of engagement on YouTube. Kind of similar to how we call it Watch Next, we're trying to find the next thing you want to watch. So unlike the homepage, which is really centered around you only, we have some additional context of what you're currently watching now. And so that's going to sometimes influence what you want to watch next. So we're gonna pull in some different videos. We're going to pull in more videos from the channel that you're watching. We're going to pull in videos that people who watched the video you're watching, what else did they watch? Mm-hmm. That's a key part of it. We're going to pull in similar videos that have like similar titles and keywords and descriptions that might be similar. And finally, we're not just going to limit it to videos that are related to the video you're just watching. This is another change that's happened over the years. It used to be called related videos because we thought that that was kind of like the thing that would work the best. And what we found through our experiments is that in addition to showing related videos, if we also show personalized recommendations that might be interesting to you but not directly related to what you're watching, people will watch more. And so sometimes you might want to go down the rabbit hole on a video and watch more related, but other times it's like, hey, I was just looking up how to tie a bow tie and I got that information, and now what I want to watch next is actually I want to catch up on my favorite vlogger or some other channel. So we don't limit suggested videos. So it's a mix of stuff that might be related and what's relevant to you, and ultimately what determines what shows up there is what performs the best. So the videos that you see there are the ones that we think are most likely to drive viewers to watch and engage. And the 80 billion data points that I talked about earlier, a lot of those data points come from there. So we just, you know, try to keep doing what's working and test various videos in different placements, and the ones that work the best tend to stick around, and the ones that don't tend to not.
All right, so now we've talked about home, Watch Next. Let's talk about search.
Right, so search, similar to Watch Next, we have some more context there because you've given us a query. So in general, we're gonna start with what you'd imagine, which is we're gonna find videos that match that query, either in the title or the descriptions, or maybe we've seen that people who search for this query tend to watch these sorts of videos. And so we'll start with a set of relevant videos, and then similar to what I was referring to earlier, there's this feedback loop. So you might say, hey, I have a thumbnail of an iPhone, and I have the text iPhone in my thumbnail, and my title is all about iPhone review, and in my description I say iPhone, iPhone, iPhone. Why am I not number one in the search for iPhone? Well, it's because we don't only look at what we call the metadata that you provide about the video, but we also look at the performance. And so we're going to see when people search for iPhone, is this the type of video that they tend to watch or not? And so the ones that you're going to see at the top aren't just the ones that match the query, but also match what the feedback has been from viewers. So it's a combination of relevance and then that feedback loop of what's actually engaging the audience.
Cool. And then trending.
Trending. This one we get so many questions about.
Yeah.
So trending is, you know, one of the things that we built trending around was to be kind of like the water cooler of YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not just a popular list. It's not the most popular videos that are getting the most views or that sort of thing. A lot of people get confused and think that's what it is. We really wanted to be represent the videos that people are having a conversation about.
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about that, what are the types of videos that people are talking about at the water cooler? They tend to be broadly appealing videos. Like, so there may be, you know, a video that's getting a lot of views, but it's within sort of like a really narrow audience.
Mm-hmm.
Like, people may not be talking about that broadly. So we do tend to focus trending on videos that are broadly appealing, for example, to different types of people with mm-hmm. different preferences. And we're also looking at videos that aren't just don't just have a lot of views in the past, but are actually have some velocity and mm-hmm. are increasing and on the rise. So that's why you might see videos in trending that, you know, may not have millions of views yet, but we're trying to actually identify those things as they're taking off. And we also look at things like, are people talking about this video on the web? Do we see that, hey, this was actually embedded in, you know, a lot of different news articles?
Mm-hmm.
And so there are conversations happening outside of YouTube about these videos. Those are some of the things we looked at to try to tap into that water cooler element.
Cool. You know, one thing I've heard people ask about trending is whether the suggestions are paid.
Yeah, I've heard that question as well. So we feel really strongly that any advertisements that we have on YouTube are clearly indicated as ads. You'll mm-hmm. see like a little yellow badge that says ad.
Mm-hmm.
Same goes for trending. There aren't any of those in mm-hmm. trending. And that's because we don't have those ads in trending. We don't have any programs where partners or advertisers mm-hmm. can pay us to place videos in trending. It's not a pay for placement thing. So all the videos you see in trending there are because of the ranking that we've come up with, and there's no way for people to pay to influence that. So it's definitely not ads or paid placements.
Cool.
Hey, insiders, hope you enjoyed the first half of that interview with Todd. Part 2 is going to be uploaded sometime next week. If you haven't already, make sure you subscribe and hit the bell notification so you will be the first to know when part 2 is available. And in the meantime, here's another video from the channel. Keep it real.